Okhin.
Hello everyone. So I'm Okhin. I work with La Qaudrature du Net, which is a French NGO fighting for digital rights. And I'm going to talk to you about how we try to basically pwn governments and parliaments. And since I'm working there as the tech person, I will also talk to you about how we develop our tools and how they're extremely useful for us to pwn all the things. So, quick introduction for La Qaudrature du Net. Basically, we're French NGO based. We're like 6% right now, paid full time for doing that, and we work with a lot of volunteers. And basically, what we try to do is to mess with parliaments because they're pushing shitty laws, and we don't want that. So we try to mess with them as hard as we can. The issue is, since we fight for digital rights and stuff like that, and some of you might have noticed, we have many laws, and many of those laws have no digital aspects. Like, if you have now health insurance law, something like that, you will have articles related to correlation of data, exploitation of data made by insurance company and stuff like that. Basically, in France, when you have now a new law, you will have some internet aspects. And even if some of us would like to get rid of all the government and parliaments and burn them and smash capitalism, it will not happen tomorrow, so we have to work with the government and parliament structures. One of the main issues we faced is what people call the elite disconnection, meaning that the representatives who are supposed to represent us are perceived as not representing us anymore, and they seem like they've established themselves as a reigning caste of what people call the establishment. So, why do we think that? Why do we think that the representatives, which, I mean, it's written in their name and their function that they should represent us, why do we think that they do not represent us? First, they try a lot to isolate themselves from the people. Like, in France, the National Assembly is 577. They're basically all white males, old, and with money or access to a lot of money. They lack of transparency. They will pretend otherwise, like, we publish our votes and everything like that, but it's basically a lie. And sometimes they will even give us fake data or wrong data, and it's hard for us to work with them. So basically, it's like obfuscating the code of the Constitution, making it ununderstandable for people. I will just show you this example of code of obfuscation. It's actually from an actual law, which is the one from the French surveillance law, and this part here describes the technical measures that will be put in place. It's basically only references to other law of text or other references to other article of law in the text. So you see, it's kind of hard to understand what's happening there. I think most of them do not understand that too. And so how do we do that at La Qaudrature? How do we fight that, and how do we try to have a better law system and to have a better protection of citizens and people and things like that? Basically, we use what we call the Triforce. We're based on those three elements, which are analysis, campaigning, and tools. The analysis, basically, we try to... it's like analyzing the system. It's taking the law, reading it, making a scheme and find how it works, what it actually means, and translate it in a language that anyone can understand, which requires a lot of time. We try to do some time make maps. We work with other collectives, such as, for instance, Regards Citoyens in France, who do that. And we do work with a lot with journalists who can help us on their analysis capacities. So we publish everything we have analyzed on our wiki or websites. And we push it hard to the media. Like, we do work a lot with media, even the mainstream ones, the ones that no one loves, but everyone reads. So we try to do that, to reach out to the public. Basically, we're publishing CVEs for democracy. You can see it that way. Campaigning is exploiting, finding exploits and backdoors in the system. Like, for instance, we have this constitutional court, and you just need to read the fucking law and to read the fucking manual of how democracy works. And it's written in it how you can pawn them. Basically, you need to write some kind of letters to some kind of person in a specific case. They will be forced to analyze it and to give you an answer about it in a certain amount of time. If they do not do that, you can complain about the fact that they didn't answer you, etc., etc., and you go up the ladder until you reach the higher stuff, which is the European Justice Court. And basically, we try to own their tools and to use them, the tools of the parliaments and other, because those tools exist because they want access to it. They want to bypass democratic process, but they never think about the fact that we, the people, can use this tool. And they do not like it very much because it's quite effective. So how do we use the exploit we found? How do we use those funny stuff we found in it to make actual change? First, we deploy our tools. So one of them, which is quite effective, is to call the representatives. It's like what we call the P-phone. Basically, it's a website. You go on this website, you have like a button, call this random representative on this specific subject. It will reach you to make the call. It will be free of charge for you. And you will be guided with like guidelines, arguments, points, and stuff like that. So you won't be alone facing a representative, and it will only take you like 10 minutes. You can do that on your coffee break, for instance. We try to get a track and to map what they did and what they said. This is what where Regard Citoyen specialized. They're getting quite good at passing national and Senate websites, extracting data from them, extracting votes for them, publishing them, keeping track of which representative actually show up and which doesn't, what they say. To that, we add another module, which is political memory, which helps us to find friends and foes. Political memory, basically, is we use the data published by Regard Citoyen and other collectives in Europe. And we try to say, okay, we do oppose this law, and if someone wrote this law, it's something that's kind of dangerous, so we give it a score, a weight. And it makes a recommendation, and when we analyze the vote, we can say, okay, these maps have voted for, which was something we wanted, or abstain and vote against, which we didn't want, and we can give them score. We can have a notation system, and so basically we can get what our allies and what our enemies in like one get HTTP request on a website, which is kind of neat when you're lost in the European Parliament. I want to know who you are speaking to, if they're your friends, if you can convince them and stuff like that. And then we have this team of people who work with us, who are mainly lawyer and lawyer students, which basically sue the government over and over and over again to the Constitutional Court and to the Administrative Court. Again, they don't like that very much. It tends to be very effective, but you need to be extremely precise in your wording. We did have some success, we did have some failure, but we're working on that, and they're the amateur's edge, that is. Basically, all those tools, human or technical tools, are what you can assemble as a metasploit for democracy. It works, it can be deployed in like now 20 minutes, I think. We have all the data from other collectives, so it works quite well. We do have some big issues, and they are mainly local issues for now. They do not publish everything. We are in France, we're in a democratic system where you have a law, which goes to the National Assembly and then to the Senate, back and forth. Like in a lot of countries. And in the National Assembly, they just vote by raising their hand most of the time, so they do not publish the vote. You do not know how many people voted for a law or against it. You do not know who voted for or against it. So it's kind of hard to get this kind of data. They do it sometimes, and it's what they call the solemn vote. So you need like a representative to ask for a solemn vote and to be followed by and to be backed by two or three other people, I think. There is some undocumented features. For instance, the group votes, like all political blocs will vote the same way. It's basically anti-constitutional, but it's not documented, it's not official, so it's hard to fight and to prove. And there is the delegation of vote, especially in the Senate, when people can vote for other people, which, again, is anti-constitutional and should be fought. And we will try to, but it's kind of hard because it's not documented, so officially they're not doing it, and you cannot prove they're doing it. So all those stuff we do, we can have some metrics. First, we're being called names in the National Assembly, which is always a good thing because it means they cannot oppose your argumentary and they cannot oppose your logic, so they just have to resign to being called names. So for instance, the five dudes in a garage, like, this is how we call ourselves now, has been how Christine Albanel called us back in the day when she was at the head of culture ministry. We have been accused of harassing representatives by Emmanuel Valls recently, which is our prime minister, I think. To give you context, harassing representative is making 1,200 phone calls for 577 representatives during a week, which is basically two phone calls for representatives. And they call that harassment. I mean, if it is harassment, then most of them should be in jail because they're kind of suckers. And we have been called amateur exegetes by Jean-Jacques Urvoas, our justice minister. And again, we have now a collective with this name because we do own the thrills. It's kind of fun and it messes with them. We did achieve some political victory. During the surveillance law, which was quite of a harsh debate because we had this attack in Paris on the 13th of November, so they pulled a lot of state of emergency law, and before that we had the surveillance law. And at the beginning, when you look at when you asked to the representative and senators and deputies, and they were saying, of course we're going to vote for this because we need more surveillance to catch people. Basically, all of them would have voted for it in the end, and by working them, by calling them, by showing them that people do care, which we flipped 20% of them. It's not enough, but it's like big progress. And next time, maybe there will be 30% of them, and until one day we will probably have a majority, which is getting nastier because we have legislative election next year, so we will have to do that all over again. And on the European level, and with the coordination of other associations, we defeated ACTA. With the same techniques, which basically is empowering people and saying, hey, you too, you can call your representative, it's not hard. You can do that on your coffee break for free. Here, what you need to say to the representative. So, how it works? How do we establish those tools? First, we do rely a lot on volunteers. As I said before, we are like a team of six people paid for full-time at La Qaudrature, and we cannot do everything on our own. So we try to rely a lot on we tend to rely on volunteers, which is kind of weird because you cannot rely on volunteers because life happens. I mean, some of them will find a boyfriend or a girlfriend, or will find a new job, or will have to move to another country, or will have a loss in their life. So at some point, most of your volunteers will stop working for you for whatever reason. And it's not because they do not want to. Most of the time, they want to work for you and they want to work with you. But if they're not reliable, they have an undisputed capacity to surprise yourself. I mean, you will find a lot of support from volunteers where you expect it less. Like, we have this 400 amendments to read for tomorrow morning at 9, and they will help you read them, parse them, find flaws in them, translate them during a night week. They will help you by following the direct stream and live tweeting the direct stream of National Assembly and Senate. They basically will be where you expect it most, less for me. And they want to work with you. I mean, they want most of the people who work with La Qaudrature are extremely happy to work with La Qaudrature, and we give them like nice hoodies and nice shirts. So they try to work with you, and you need to create a place where it will be fun and interesting for them to work with you. You need to create an inclusive context because you do not know who will be the next committer to your code. You do not know who will get access to your code and will read it and will submit you a patch that will solve this issue you had no time to spend on. So you need to be as most inclusive as you can. So you need to have some kind of more or less official community rules, and you need to be able to enforce it. I personally have no remorse to expel someone with just wasting our time and destroying the work we're doing and the job we're doing. And also, you cannot work with deadlines. You cannot say, well, I need this transition made for tomorrow 9 a.m., so happy volunteers, work on it. You need to do that yourself. You can work on some soft deadlines, like, yeah, if we'd like to have that soon, but it's not urgent. But everything that's an emergency that needs to be fixed and done, you need to do that in-house, because you cannot ask volunteers to just code 20 hours a day for you for free. They just have to eat and to feed themselves and to buy, to pay the bills and the rent and stuff like that. Another important point when you manage this kind of community is that you have to accept all contributes. And for that, you need to be able to have a context where pushing a contribution is easy. You shouldn't have, like, we need to review this patch through 5 people, and you need to create an account there and there, and to open a bug tracker report, and to do, because most of the time, the volunteers will have stopped at the second step. And we do have some people who enjoy doing code reviews and quality stuff. So, okay, get the patch, accept them, and try to put them in production as soon as possible, because for your volunteers who work with you, it will be extremely rewarding. Like, hey, I've just patched something, and I can see that on Memopol, and it's visible online and on production. I've done something today. It's extremely valuable for them to see that what they do actually matters. One other point is, like, you developers and volunteers are basically grown-ups most of the time. So you can't give them full autonomy and full decision over the project decision. We should stop with the startup philosophy of micromanage everything. Just give them the tool and let them have fun with it. If you really need something, open issues and try to engage with them. But don't do micromanagement stuff. That's how you burn people out, and that's how they flee your project and will never come back again. And they should be adult enough to know on what they want to work and what they enjoy to work and what are the skills they want to develop and what are the frameworks they want to play with. So try to be open on this subject, like, I want to try this specific framework. Okay, so let's play with this framework. I don't know nothing about it. I will learn it on reading the fucking manual. You will have the possibility to have fun with it, and we will deploy it in production because we do that. So try to not have too high standards when, if you want to manage this kind of stuff. That's what we try to do. And the nope part, the what you should not do, basically, you should eat your own dog food. We at La Qaudrature, we fight for decentralization, for autonomy, for free software, for stuff like that. So we have to use, the way we code is the way we do politics, and it's how our tools will look like. So we need to self-host, or to rely on small companies, or even better, to work with other collectives. So we do try to host all our code. We don't run anything on Amazon Web Server. We don't run anything on Heroku. We do not host our code on GitHub, etc. You do not necessarily need a wiki and a mailing list for your project to start. You most of the time need to just read the commit log, and this is how you will see your developers and volunteers contribute. You will see just, okay, they just did some code today. It's nice. They're still alive. When you look at their activity and they're dead for like 1 week, you can start to get worried because they haven't done anything, and sometimes it's just because they're on holiday or have this thing at work or this family issue and stuff like that. And developer wants to work on interesting things. You want them to work on important things. The important thing should be interesting for them enough to work on. If you have to do those boring patch review system, nobody will do that besides you, and it's important to run them, so try to find interesting stuff for them to do and try to be open about that. So that's how we manage to produce our tools, basically everything we do at La Quadrature. Next thing is, I don't know if a lot of you are familiar with the French state of stuff, which is quite bad nowadays. It's not as bad as in Iran or Saudi Arabia or Turkey, but it's getting bad. So how do we survive that? One important thing is, you need to take care of yourself, you need to take breaks. I work only 4 days a week because else I'm going to burn out, and I've really tried to have, like, on, when I'm on a weekend, I'm on a weekend, I don't work, which is kind of peculiar because I work with volunteers who can work only during out-of-office hours and on the weekend, so again, I need to trust them and to give them autonomy on the project. And the more they're autonomous, the more they're happy about it, and the more fun they have, and the more code they contribute, and the more things they're doing, and the more easily it is to change stuff in the parliament. There's one thing, so I maintain the tools we use, but I'm not like Evil Corp or stuff like that. So I can have, I cannot have like a 99.999999% SLA. That's not possible because I'm alone. I need to sleep at some point. I need to have breaks. So you have to expect that your tools will break at the worst possible time. It happens, and that's why I won't show you anything live because they're working, but I don't want to try it and break them while trying to show you how they work. Some of the thing we do is basically blowing some steam because when you have those representative, agent of government, prime ministers, presidential, but all of them saying that you're basically kind of the, some terrorist group and you should be defeated and dissolved and stuff like that. You need to blow some steam. So I try to do the things that I can't have a laugh at because sometimes you just need that. So we build the, what I call the IMSI captcha. Which is a multidimensional troll, because this is what you would have when you want to land on laquadrature.net web page. So yeah, it looks like the Cloudflare captcha that some of you might know about. So I'm using that because most of the people who do not use Tor don't see the issue with the Cloudflare captcha. So now when they come on our website, they can see the issue with the Cloudflare captcha. Also, I change the text a little bit, and they say, well, the captcha doesn't matter, we don't care about it, you should probably try to use Tor and do to think about it and stuff like that. And when you click on not a robot stuff, you see that. Basically, it says, here are the threats, you have to click on the threats on freedom. And those three guys here are our prime minister, minister of interior, and minister of justice. So you see, again, multi-level, multi-dimensional trolling, it's fun. It took me like only 2 days to do that, and I mean, it felt good to do it. Like, okay, it's easy, it's cheap, but hey, I've done something good today, I did have a laugh about it, and okay, I can move on. One other point, can you raise your hand if you can understand this, please? Okay, so if you can understand that, you can understand how the legislative system works. It's easier than that. Seriously, it's the same skill set of analysis. Like, it's like reading a source code, and you see those function code and pointers and the handler everywhere and the array and all this weird stuff that people who do not have this kind of skill set of skill mind cannot see. So, coding is doing politics, and politics is, do works when you are on a legislative process, do works a bit like code. Regard Citoyen did even go as far as putting a website online where they do publish a law project and put it in a Git tree so you can see all the amendments, what they actually do on the text, on the final text. They're working right now on finding lobby text and doing pattern recognition in amendment and stuff to see, okay, those amendments have been, in fact, been written by lobbies and stuff like that. And one last point is, when you code and when you produce tools, you need to, those tools to be usable by people. So, one of the issues I had when I entered La Quadrature last year was that to send an email to some to put on our newsletter, basically, you needed to have a terminal login as root on a server and exec PHP script from there, which is kind of a good way to never send you a newsletter. So I did set up some tools like CVCRM stuff, which enables our user to actually use them and to not fight with it and to not get angry at it because he don't understand and it's not working and stuff like that. And so I think one important stuff is doing those nerdy projects that no one uses can be fun because it's a good way to learn how to code and stuff like that. But at some point, we need to reach usability. We need to have people actually using what we spend our time on. So that's what we try to do at La Qaudrature, and we're releasing everything and documenting the installation process of everything as much as we can. And one thing, it's when you're doing politics, sometimes you will feel bad because you cannot go to a protest, or you're too afraid, or you do not manage well in front of cops, which is what they try to achieve. And it's perfectly okay. You're doing amazing stuff when you contributed to this kind of project. So, and there are people who are quite good at getting into a protest and a riot, but will never be able to understand how Python works. So it's okay. Don't feel bad about the fact that you cannot go to a protest, or you're too scared to get there, or you think you're going to get arrested. It's fine. And to do that, we need to stop with individualization and all the myth of bureaucracy and stuff like that. Like when you need to not being depressed, you need to have a feeling of achievement, of achieving some things, and you cannot do that if you're in a collective and that this collective per se do nothing, but all the individuals in the collective are doing something, but not you. So try to work as a collective and publish things as a collective, and everyone who will be part of this collective will feel like, okay, we did something here. That's something that's important, and I think we do that with Qaudrature a lot. Like, when you help them, you say, yes, thanks to all your benevolent and to all our volunteers, and we did something great. And this way is not only the six people in the garage, it's like everyone claiming to be part of Qaudrature. It's the Qaudrature community, it's a lot of people. I think it's important we try to kill those myths of individuality and the individual grid, because they're becoming more and more gatekeepers, and they protect new people to enter and to join your project and to help you owning and pulling parliaments. And one thing is that in the end, you'll end up managing. Whatever the government creeps says and do, you'll manage, you'll survive the day, and the day after that, and the day after that. Even if you do not achieve political victory, at least you'll have been a pain for them when they will be like shaving in the front of the mirror in the morning and think about what they had to do what they will have to do today. They will think, oh no, those guys of La Qaudrature will again bother with me and mess with me. I don't want that. And they will have a shitty day because of you. So they're making our life shittier, so we should do the same. And when you meet them, you probably will see in their eyes, not those guys, not them, not again. So, this guy is actually our prime minister. No, Minister of Interior, is Bernard Cazeneuve. He has a good face, you can put on memes, and it's quite fun to do that. So it's done, basically. We achieved bridging political gaps because we have people calling representative and representative not feeling that alone and disconnected anymore. They know it. They know we're watching them. They don't like it, and they will try to fight it, but they know we're watching them. And we had fun doing that, which is quite important. And we met like a bunch of cool people and interesting people, and we learned a lot of things going there, and we're gonna do that again and again. So, if you want to contribute, we have like a GitLab instance on git.laquadrature.net. If you have a GitHub account, you can connect there. I've activated the stuff. The tool I spoke about, which is Memopol, which is one of our big projects right now. It's the one that keeps tabs on maps and says them and gives them a score about how bad they are or how good they are. It's memopol.lqdn.fr. We have our website at www.laquadrature.net. Don't hesitate to fork us, but not on GitHub, please. There's a lot of people I want to thank, especially some collectives like Regard Citoyen, because they do a lot of open data on French Parliament website. And when you look at those websites, it's something where you will lose some sanity. I want to thanks to Paltrack, which is doing the same with the European Parliament. The Memopol Dream Team, as I call them, because they're basically two guys working like for 1 year to resurrect this project and help me understand it and integrate it. And they're recruiting people. And if you want to do some Python development and Django development and with an interesting bunch of people and work on interesting problematics, like what does this core mean for this person, just go talk to them. I want to thank all the LQDN staff and all the volunteers who work with us every day. I want to reassure you that I've armed no politicians and no representatives during the process of making this presentation. You can reach me there and you can send me emails there. Thank you if you have questions, and I'm open for discussion.
Okay, so any questions? Nobody?
Yeah, over there.
Yes, my question is oriented towards the communication and decision making. So I was wondering, when the government, let's say, makes some propositions for laws, etc., one way is to say no, it's bad. Another way is to try to constructively say, okay, this is bad. However, this is better. Or if you tweak this, then it will be beneficial for everyone. Now, like my question is, how do you manage to go to such a complexity with both some core team and some volunteers that have different backgrounds, different experiences, and different knowledges?
We do not have really a recipe for that. We do it most of the time on the fly. One thing is, in France right now, there's a lot of laws that are passed as what they call the emergency process. It's the law gets in the National Assembly, Senate, and then they have this commission between the two chambers to produce a law in like less than a month and with hundreds of amendments. So most of the time, when we see this kind of project, we basically say, okay, this will be bad because they want to do this kind of stuff. We won't get into the details because it's useless. You should reject all the project. And we publish that, and we try to find help with journalists and analysts and people who want to work with us. So it's kind of, it will depend on the context. On the Republic Numeric Law, we have like those amendments for the commons are quite important. We want to push that forward. Those ones are quite bad. We want to forbid them. But sometimes you can just do, like, okay, it's the law for surveying basically everyone. You can just throw that away, and this is why. Did I answer the question?
Okay, more questions? Comments? I have a question for you, which is, how do you get the volunteers, and have you seen like an increase? I mean, do you get more volunteers after something big is happening, a big political event, or, for example, with the terrorist attacks? Does that have a drop in volunteers? Does that create more?
We try to. So we run this fundraising campaign once a year. So the next one will start like in November. And last year, it started like in November, like on the 8th of November, something like that. And on the 13th of November, we did have these terror attacks. And then an insane amount of bullshit at the political level. What happened is we did stop our campaign because we didn't want to try to capitalize on death and stuff like that. So we did stop it and wait for something to happen and to think about how we would do it. And soon we noticed that each time Bernard Cazeneuve, François Hollande, or basically anyone was saying something on TV, we will add people giving us money. So we basically had like this extremely efficient communication team at the head of government who basically did all the work for us. Because each time they say, we need to survey people, we need to install more police and stuff like that, we were getting money and we were getting attraction and attention and and attention, and people came in. We have this issue with Memopol, which the position I'm occupying at La Quadrature is quite new. It's been open for like 2 years. And before that, there was like no one in charge of managing tools and developer communities. So the project Memopol is quite an old one, and it has been forgotten. And since it didn't receive active support from La Quadrature, it basically died. And 2 years ago, the guy who had the position before me bootstrapped a new group of developers to working on that and give them support and feedback and saying, you're doing something good, you're doing something fun and fantastic, and it's important to say that to your people who works with you. And now we're recruiting. We have been at the last PyCon, so we have more developers coming in, and so it will depend on the event. I mean, when you have like nothing to do because they're quiet, because they're busy running for job, for office, you will lose some volunteers, and when there is some activity, they will say, oh, yes, I remember I'm supposed to work on that with La Quadrature, and they will connect back and reach you.
Any more questions, comments? Okay, well, thank you very much.